Thank you so much. Good afternoon. Like you've heard, my name's Allan Musonda. I'm coming from Zambia.
Just wondering, where is Zambia?
Yes. So Zambia, in relation to Spain, this is the whole of Africa. That is Spain, and Zambia is here. Yes, just here, neighbors to 8 countries, including Zimbabwe, Malawi, and Mozambique, and just away from South Africa. We are 15 million people in Zambia, and I think that's about Zambia. I'm coming from Copperbelt University, which is in Kitwe, here. There I'm a lecturer of mathematics education. What it means, we prepare secondary school teachers, would be secondary school teachers who are going to teach as teachers of mathematics. So I prepare them in terms of how they are going to teach and the mathematics they are going to teach. I'm here as a visiting researcher under the short-term scholarships, and I've been here for a month. This is my end of state presentation. Having introduced myself, I'm looking at what we are looking at. I'm looking at the algebraic competences and emotional intelligence of first year Bachelor of Science Education students at Copperbelt University. There's a background why I chose this topic. It's part of my PhD program, and it's also part of the intention of the school in which I am, that we investigate why our students are failing. Just like any other institution, institutions are interested in their students achieving, because they come not to joke or to play around, but to achieve something and be able to contribute after their graduation to the growth of their various countries. Though this is the intentions of institutions, usually that is not the case. We see other students failing to complete because they are failing in certain subjects or in all subjects at times. So poor academic performance by the students is due to many things, but much more is because these students don't have the competencies required in that particular course or subject. So the competences are important. So it's like competences are being influenced by many factors. So in this, my study, I said, of course, there are many competences affecting achievement, and out of so many factors, some of them I don't know, I isolated emotional intelligence as one of those factors. My arriving at emotional intelligence came about through my literature search. On the internet, I found that emotional intelligence was a popular topic, and people were saying with emotional intelligence, we can achieve much. You don't just need the cognitive intelligence, which we all know, but you need the emotional intelligence. And in this, my study, I've defined what it is. Within no time, I will define it and see how it relates to competences and performance. Now, I first go to define what competences are according to those authors and according to the Turing project. Competences are seen to be the knowledge, the understanding, the skills, and the abilities which an individual student or person possesses. So it can be knowledge, it can be abilities to do something, can be the skill, and it can also be the understanding. And the competences are divided basically into two: the generic competences and the subject-specific competences. Generic competences, as the word implies, are general. Those things which we want our graduates, when they complete their degrees, to be able to do. Obviously, we expect all graduates to be problem solvers, regardless of the subject which they've studied. Whether they studied physics, engineering, economics, we expect them to be a solution to our countries. Now, having said that, Our tuning project has identified many subjects specific competences, and mathematics, I find it to be one of those subjects, and I'm happy because I have this mathematics background, both as a teacher of mathematics and also as a teacher educator. And I isolated three of those mathematics specific competences. One, which is profound knowledge of elementary mathematics as is being taught in secondary schools. Obviously, anybody who's training to be a teacher is expected to be competent in the mathematics taught at secondary school. And also the ability to extract qualitative information from quantitative data. If somebody is given a question, a word question, you should be able to translate it into a mathematical equation and be able to solve it. Several examples of such questions exist in mathematics. And in my questionnaires, I formulated many of those questions where you have a word question and then you translate it into a mathematical question. That goes to the third point, which is ability to formulate problems mathematically and in symbolic form. The students, when they graduate, one of the subject-specific areas, they should be able to translate the English language into mathematics language and attach symbols, the X, the Y, the Z, and solve the solution, whether it's the simultaneous equations, whether they are quadratic equations, as the case may be. Now, when you look at mathematics has many branches. There's algebra, there's arithmetic, there's geometry, there's trigonometry, there's calculus. And part of statistics is also in mathematics. Now, I isolated algebra to say, okay, we have the subject-specific competences, which is mathematics, but within mathematics, there are other branches, which as you advance in mathematics, they even emerge to be subjects on their own. You can major in statistics, you can major in algebra. Now, I'm saying for first-year students, algebra is very important because it's found in all other branches. It runs across. And these branches, they're connected to each other, but algebra is more connected because whatever question you may have, you need to apply algebra to solve it. Because most of the things which are done in algebra are equations, and equations are all over. So concepts in algebra run in all branches of mathematics. Like the question which is there, we are saying given 0 degrees, then theta, 360 degrees, solve cosine squared theta plus 3 sine theta is plus 3 is equal to 0. This basically is not an algebraic question. It is a trigonometric question. But you need the algebraic principles to solve it, like I've demonstrated here. First, you need to express, you need to take what we call the identity, which is this one, is it? This one, the identity in trigonometry, where this plus this is equal to 1. And then make cosine squared theta the subject of the formula. All those I'm mentioning are competences in algebra, subject of the formula. That's why I've put them in blue. Express in similar terms, that's an algebraic vocabulary. Subject of the formula, and you have that. And then replace, where there's cosine squared theta, you replace it with this here. So that they're all in one terms. You are talking of sine theta squared or sine theta only. Now, when you reach this stage, yes, this stage, you can now replace this in here and the equation will result into this. And eventually the equation will be this one when you multiply by negative 1. So such types of equation, when you look at it, it's trigonometric, but it reminds you of quadratic equations. And you say, okay, in algebra, I remember we did x squared plus bx plus c is equal to 0, which is a quadratic equation where a can be anything, but it shouldn't be 0. When it is 0, then it stops being a quadratic equation. It becomes a linear equation. When a is 0, it will be bx plus c, which is linear, another type of equation. So we are saying a must never be 1, must never be 0. If it is 0, then everything collapses and becomes linear. But b can be anything, c can be anything. So that is the QE, quadratic equations, another type of equation. Then we say, okay, this resembles that. Suppose I say, instead of sine, I say let sine be sine theta, let x be sine theta. And then wherever there's sine, I replace it with x. Then I'll say, okay, here I have sine, but it's squared, so I'll square my x plus 3x. Wherever there's sine, you put x. Minus 4 is equal to 0. At this stage, okay, that's nice, but I'm just demonstrating how algebra can be used, yes, in another branch. And these examples are many, even in geometry. For lack of time, I could have demonstrated one. Yes. So here now, you use algebraic principles to factorize, and this is a perfect kind of factorization, because there are four kinds of methods you can use to factorize. You can use completing the square method, you can use graphical method, you can use just the roots themselves, or the graph, or the computer. So now, we say these competences, as outlined, you solve the question, and after you reach x is minus 4, and x is 1, you go back to the trigonometric kind of arrangement. You use the algebra to find the solution. Then you say, okay, but my x is sine theta. So I'll replace it. Sine theta is minus 4. Sine theta is 1. But this does not exist. So you discard it. In mathematics, not everything you find is a solution. You need to interpret it. So this one doesn't exist. If you have a calculator, you punch what is arc sine of negative 4. The calculator will say error, either error 2, error 1, etc., etc. But if you say theta is arc 1, you get 90 degrees. So this is our solution. We've used algebra to find the answer to our trigonometric problem. Now, algebra-specific competences and emotional intelligence. What is the relationship between algebraic competences and emotional intelligence? Why the two? It's because while algebra is running through all other branches, we suspect our students are failing because they don't have enough emotional intelligence. Now, what is this emotional intelligence? Goleman, one of the pioneers of emotional intelligence, articulates 5 components of emotional intelligence. 1, knowing your emotions. We all have emotions. Though some people say, I don't have emotions. It's not true. We all have emotions. So we should know our emotions, and then how to manage those emotions in relation to other people's emotions. And that will help us manage relationships with other people. Because other people have emotions, we also have emotions. Then we know how to motivate ourselves, even as we recognize and understand other people's emotions. Now, if you look at my diagram, starting from here, when you go in this direction, you're talking of the other person. When you go in this direction, you're talking about yourself. While you know your emotions, you should manage them and motivate yourself to go higher. Nobody doesn't want to go higher. We don't want to remain at the same place. We all want to go higher. So we motivate ourselves while recognizing, understanding other people's emotions also to progress. This direction, you manage relationships. You can't know people's emotions per se, but you need to manage relationships. You can't manage other people's emotions, but you can manage the relationships while recognizing and understanding their emotions. Now, this is helpful in learning, as literature has suggested. Emotions are helpful in learning because with help from others, you can progress. But if others are shunning you, then it becomes a problem, more especially to first-year students who are just coming in the university, trying to settle down. They don't have friends. Some of them, like in Zambia, they're coming from remotest places you can ever think of. Very remote, and maybe from his school is the only one who has come to university. He needs to know to say, well, I'm here alone. I need to make friends. And he needs to involve emotions. Emotional intelligence has a history, ranging back, some people say, as far back as Darwin. But in my study, I'm looking at 1920s, when Thondike suggested that there's a kind of social intelligence, which means understanding, that is social intelligence, understanding other people's emotions and living in harmony with other people. Social intelligence, as the word implies, living in a society with other people. However, the term emotional intelligence came into existence for the first time, according to my study, in 1985, when a doctoral student by the name of Wayne Leon Pine used it in his dissertation. And then people got interested. In 1990, two researchers, Peter Salovey and John Mayer, also started trying to study the concept. And they said, emotional intelligence has to do with coping with one's emotions and making them relevant to other people. However, it was in 1995 again when Goleman, who was a journalist, suggested the five domains which I talked about. And apart from him, other researchers came on shore, including Schutt and others. I've mentioned Schutt because I'm using his model of measuring emotional intelligence in this particular study. We have measurement tools to measure emotional intelligence. And these measurement tools are divided into two: self-report questionnaires or performance kind of tools. And many people have developed these tools. But in my study, I'm looking at the Schutt self-report emotional intelligence, which has different names, but it's the same thing. Others call it SAIS, others call it SAIT with one S, others call it SSRET, but it's the same thing. It was developed by Schutt, and it's a Likert type of scale, the 5-point Likert scale, where a student or a participant measures himself against the 5 points, ranging from one, very strongly disagree, to very strongly agree with 5 points. Segment of the problem, why the study? I've already given hints why this study is necessary. The failure rate of our students at Copperbelt University, which is in short we call CBU, is not so good. When I say the performance is not good, I mean many students in mathematics getting less than 50%. Those 50%, that is our passing mark. So many of them getting less than that. Then the questions come. These are the best students we've collected from the country, from all over the nation. Back home, we call them the cream of the nation. You know what cream is, all of us. Yes, the best of the brains. But the same best of the brains are failing, as reflected here. For the last 4 years, that has been the performance. And I've been teaching the other groups, not these, but the other groups of first years, engineering students, natural resources students, but the performance is more or less the same. Why should these students fail? Because failure impacts negatively on many stakeholders: government, the university itself, their parents, and the students themselves. Instead of graduating on time, they are delayed. Some of them are even excluded, apart from being delayed, because they need to clear the course. So it's of concern to say, why should they fail? What factors are causing their failure? Is it emotional intelligence? Hence, the study. The purpose of the study is to examine the relationship of the algebra, algebraic competences, and emotional intelligence. How does what I was explaining in terms of algebra relate to emotional intelligence? Is emotional intelligence a factor? And to do that, three research questions have been isolated. I'm using the word isolated because this is a big study. There are other research questions, but for this particular presentation, I've isolated three. Is grade 12, when I say grade 12, I mean the last grade at secondary school. We call it grade 12, that is at high school, the last grade, before you go into university. We call it grade 12. Is the grade 12 level algebraic competences of the students in correlation with their first year university level algebraic competences? The algebra they learn at university and the algebra they are coming with from secondary school, is there a correlation? If there's correlation, well and good. If there isn't, then where is the problem? Number two, is there a significant relationship between students' university algebra test scores and their emotional intelligence? Number three, is there any difference between males and females in terms of their emotional intelligence? The study I've already indicated is very important to the university, to us as lecturers, to understand the students we are teaching, and also other researchers who may wish to investigate more on this particular topic. Methodology, I used a correlation research design for this particular study, and I carried out the reliability tests for the instruments. For the SAIT, it is already validated, but I did also check on its reliability by calculating the Cronenberg alpha, and it was found to be 0.79, which wasn't bad, it's very good. And then for the algebra test, I did what we call parallel forms of reliability, where you administer two similar tests after an interval to the same group of students or participants. And I got for the algebra test at grade 12, 0.889, yes, which is 0.9. And for the university one, 0.859, which is almost 0.9. Almost the same. The participants are 143 students from Copperbelt University who are studying to be teachers of mathematics. And they did purposive sampling, meaning I took the whole group by purpose because they are the group I'm interested in. That is 25 females and 82 males. They fully participated. What it means by fully participating is out of the 143 on the register, some didn't even report. Others just wrote one test. They didn't write all the three instruments. They didn't participate in them, so they were excluded. And what did I find? First research question, is there a correlation between the 12 level algebra and the first year university algebra? I use Pearson's product moment coefficient of correlation, and I found that the R was 0.665, which when you round off is 0.7. And the P, I found it 0.00, less than 0.01, the level of significance. And with this, I concluded to say, yes, there's correlation, because 0.7 is good enough. An error, there's correlation, quite all right. Meaning, this is good, because the students are building on what they already know into what they want to know. So this is fine. And second research question, is there a significant correlation between students' university algebra test scores and their emotional intelligence scores? Again, I use Pearson's product moment coefficient of correlation method. And for this one, I found R to be negative 0.145 and the p-value to be 0.135. So since the p-value is greater than 0.05, it's not significant at this level, 0.05 level, for a two-tailed test. So what does this mean? It means emotional intelligence, in this particular case, is not a factor because the p-value is greater than the significance level at which this test was set. So it's not an issue. There are other issues affecting performance or achievement of students in algebra. The third research question, is there a significant difference between the males and females, first-year students, in their emotional intelligence? Who are more emotionally intelligent, the males, the females? I did a t-test, and I found that the mean difference of the two kinds of gender is 5.168. The t is -3.584, and the degrees of freedom is 5.754. Then at significance level 0.05, I found 0.00, which is less than 0.05, with a 95% confidence level, with a difference of 2.497 and 7.838. Since the p-value is less than the significance level, I took the results as saying, yes, there's significance between the males and females. And when I look at the data further, I found that the females are the higher mark, and the mean difference of 5.168 is suggesting to me that the female students are more intelligent than the male students. So there's this difference. And this agrees with the other studies which I went through during my literature review, to say generally, in most cultures, females are more emotionally aware than the men. They are considerate, they are kind, and all those issues. Now, what am I concluding? And what are the recommendations? I'm concluding that I found a fairly good correlation between achievement at grade 12 and achievement at university level. That is, for me, that is a good conclusion. It agrees with theory to say students build on what they know in order to know what they don't know. So if they are good at grade 12, we expect them to be good. There should be some correlation. Though they are failing, there should be some agreement. Though the same topics taught at grade 12 are the same topics which they build on at university. Number two, the low achievement in first year university algebra at CBU, in algebra and mathematics in general, can be attributed to other factors, not emotional intelligence. In this particular study, emotional intelligence is not a factor, but other factors, maybe lack of resources, maybe other issues, not emotional intelligence. Number three, yes, I've already mentioned this one. There's a significant difference between the males and the females, as other studies have also suggested. The recommendation is that both females and males, they need to receive formal training in EI, because the intelligence which the students, female students, demonstrated is not of training. So both of them, it's recommended that they undergo some training. Then further research should consider three or more universities, not just one university. Three universities in Zambia, we have about three public universities. Of course, others have come on board. So somebody can do a study which involves all the other universities. In my case, in this, my program, apart from this, I'll investigate again the next intake before I can publish, before I can graduate in my PhD program. my dean said, you can't just base your findings on one group. You need another group, if possible, a third group. And then that's when you can come with conclusive results. Thank you for listening. Thank you for your attention. I end here and invite your questions.